Just in terms of facts, that is the facts of the case. And Jen, I do have one thing marked as states exhibit number one. This is a copy of Detective Jonathan Link's report, which also includes the statement of the defendant. We had it marked as states exhibit number one. We'd like to introduce that, along with states exhibit number two, three, and four for the purpose of this hearing.
Neil, could be heard on any one of the exhibits?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. States one through four.
Judge, we do have family members present this time. Judge, at the appropriate time, they are available just right back here in the front row. We have four family members. Just present, we have Rusty Coffey. He's the stepfather of Jordan Skaggs. We have Melanie Coffey, who's the mother. We also have Matthew and Carissa Coffey, brother and sister-in-law of Jordan. Just all of them came in from Virginia.
Okay.
Be here today at the appropriate time, Judge.
Thank you.
Judge, that'll be showing for the state in terms of the factual basis, but not any statements made by the family.
Okay. Thank you. We'll.
And Judge, I do renew the motion to introduce ones, two, three, and four.
Okay, they are.
He has been a model inmate in the jail facility here.
And they, at one point in time, he kept falling out of the top bunk because of his nightmares. And as a result of that, they placed him in a cell by himself, not because of his misbehavior, but because of his nightmares, so that he'd be able to sleep on the bottom bunk and be alone. He has been one of the nicest clients I've ever had in 40 years of practicing law. Behind me is his mother and father, Susie Skaggs and Chris Skaggs, Gary Skaggs. They're his parents. They've been supporting him throughout this. And they also love Jordan. And they also love Zane and the two of the children. That's why it's such a tragic event today, right? Chris Skaggs offered about 18 months ago a plea bargain for 25 years, pleading guilty to second degree. That was about 18 months ago. The state declined to accept that offer. Obviously, that's their choice, but he has acknowledged his guilt from the outset. And then finally, we would say that having practiced law for 40 years in the military in the state of North Carolina, this case represents what happens when politics gets involved in a case. We would submit that if the judge had any discretion here in terms of the sentence, we submit that the evidence we would have presented would have not given Chris Skaggs a life without parole sentence. But the politicians in Raleigh decided to take that power away from the court and made an automatic life without parole. And Your Honor, you've heard a lot of cases over your career as a judge that were benefited from some really bad defendants. Up until July 15, 2014, he was a hero. Unfortunately, on that day, he lost it. We certainly don't blame Jordan. She should not have died. She should not have been shot. But they both needed help. He needed help. He couldn't get help. And she needed help. And she had her own demons inside her. So we blame the state of North Carolina in the sense of making this an automatic life without parole. Because a couple months ago, Your Honor, you heard the case of Sebastian Mendez, who killed his five-month-old baby, who also killed his girlfriend, stuffed them both in a suitcase, and he got life without parole. And again, it's not because of the court, but it's because of the legislature in Raleigh that both those individuals are going to have life without parole, and that's not fair. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Your Honor. Judge, as I indicated earlier, we've got family members of Jordan Skaggs who are present. They came in from Virginia yesterday. They've actually been down here many times. We met with Russell and Melody many times in the last few years, as well as with the telephone. Because I know that Ms. Coffey has a statement she'd like to make to the court.
Okay.
Just, I have one moment.
Okay, every time you... That's fine. Thank you very much, Ms. Coffey. If you would just state your full name and the community in which you live.
Russell Muller Coffey in Mount Sullivan, Virginia.
Okay, thank you for appearing.
COFFEY.
Okay. Go ahead and take your time and tell the court what you wish. Court to hear.
Everyone to know that Jordan is our community. She's our daughter. will continue. And that's all I have to say.
Thank you very much. Julie, anyone else?
Yeah, I spoke to Ms. Coffey. Just Ms. Coffey and I have met sometimes, several times, because we're also on the phone again as late as Friday. And Judge, I want just to tell a little bit about Jordan. Judge, Jordan was born July 27, 1983, in Daytona Beach, Florida. Judge, she did in fact have three children. She graduated from Fort Defiance High School in Virginia in 2001. After high school, she was a flight attendant for U.S. Air in Charlottesville, Virginia for about 2 years. She was also a trainer for Nautilus in Stanton, Virginia, and then the YMCA in Stanton for a total of about 3 years. She also worked on the family farm. Zane was born on August 14th of 2006. Jordan had previously married to a Christopher Stowers Marine, and they moved to Camp Pendleton in February of 2008. Alexander was born February 28th of 2009. Jordan and Tudor moved back to Virginia. Jordan and Christopher Stowers were separated July 9th and eventually divorced. Jordan met Christopher Skaggs at Camp Pendleton. And they were married here in Jacksonville, North Carolina in May of 2011. They had a child together, Eliana, that's E-L-L-I-A-N-A, who was born March 7th, 2012. So Jordan had a total of three children. The victim, the defendant, and those three children moved to 501 Cherry Blossom Lane in Richlands about the summer of 2012. Rusty and Melody Coffey would come down and visit them at the residence. Judge, Ms. Coffey's told me that about 3:30 a.m. on July 14, 2014, two deputies in Virginia went to their residence and told them Jordan had been shot. They also told her that Jordan did not make it. Within an hour, the family was on the way to Jacksonville, North Carolina. When arriving in Jacksonville, North Carolina, they went to the Onslow County Sheriff's Office. They met with Detective Jonathan Lincoln, seated to my right. And just repeatedly throughout this, they've expressed their gratitude, their thanks to the Onslow County Sheriff's Office for their hard work in this case and their investigation. I thank them as well. Melody was also going to testify, was also provided discovery, that she had seen previously some injuries about the person of Jordan. Jordan always wanted to give him one more chance, though. That's what she was going to say. Right now, the three children are split up. I'm not going to go to where each one lives, but all three are now split up. All of them are up in the state of Virginia. Judge, just a tragic situation for all involved. But the reason I want to make sure you heard those things is because Jordan Skaggs was a real, living, breathing human being at one point, just like all of us are right now. She actually lived on this earth. She done some things in her life that were very good. And from all information we received, she was a very good mother for these three children. She loved her three children. Judge, I do have a couple of photographs I'd just like to pass up to the court so you can see. I'm not going to introduce those because the family would like them back. I have showed those to defense counsel. Judge, the first one is a family photograph. The victim, Jordan Skaggs, would be the one on the immediate left, far left. Judge, we also have just another photograph, Judge. One is of the three children. We have a photograph of Jordan, the son, kissing him. And then we have a photograph of Jordan by herself, smiling. So just like in all these cases, you know, when we do murder cases, there's always one person who's not present. If it's a single homicide, that is. There's always that one person who's not present, it's always a victim. You always can hear a lot about the defendant in these cases, and you've tried a bunch of them just like I have. But you, as the victim knows, we usually just have a few pictures, of course, and maybe just a few memories. But I guess I want to say those things on behalf of the family, because she really was a living, breathing human being who was loved by her family and who loved her family. Judge, in terms of the worksheet, Judge, I've had the defense look at this. He will be a prior record level number one. There's also a restitution worksheet. The state is not requesting type of restitution. The state of North Carolina covered the funeral expenses. I also just passed the witness attendance certificate. I just passed that. That would be the cops coming down from Virginia. Judge, the state would request that in light of the nature of this offense, that the court in fact accept the plea of first degree murder, that the court in fact sentence the defendant to life without parole. Judge, I know there's just talk about the sentence being life without parole. Well, that is the law of the state of North Carolina. It is what it is. And I believe it's an appropriate law in the state of North Carolina, that people receive life without parole for first-degree murder. There's only two options, death or life without parole. This has been mandated by the legislature, and Judge, due to the nature of this offense, the state is requesting that this defendant be sentenced to the rest of his natural life without parole in the North Carolina Department of Adult Correction. Thank you.
Jag's family, I'm sorry you have to experience all this. I wish you also the best. I'm sorry for the fact that your son has got to be sentenced to life in prison without parole. I thank you all for being here and the support you provided to the parties. I thank the attorneys for their hard work in this case. It's not easy to prosecute these cases. It's not easy to defend these cases. The sheriff's and I thank you for your dedicated efforts in this case and all the other cases you presented to this court over the years. The court has considered the record proper, the evidence, and the factual presentation offered. Answers the defendant to the questions handed to him under oath, the statements of the lawyers for the defendant and the statements of the prosecutor. The court finds that there is a factual basis for the entry of his plea of guilty, that Mr. Skaggs is satisfied with his attorney's legal services. The court further finds he is competent to stand trial. And the plea of guilty was his informed choice made freely, voluntarily. Neil, are there any medical, psychiatric, or other records that you would wish the court to accompany the defendant?
I don't have it with me, Your Honor. There is a report from our psychiatrist, but I didn't want to offer it in terms of any kind of controversy about the plea or anything.
Okay.
So if that's a result of
if you request it, I will. Submit it, I'll ask the clerk. sir. You probably have a copy.
Yes, sir. They provided to us in the central discovery, Your Honor.
Very well. Court made those findings. Court further finds the defendant pled guilty in 14 CRS 54532. First degree murder. Defense date being July 13, 2014. Court makes no prior record level finding because none is required. However, he is record level one with no prior record. Court further makes no written findings. This is the term imposed is for a class A felony. Court orders defendant to be in prison, life in prison without parole. In the custody of North Carolina Department of Public Corrections. And should receive credit for the time of his arrest spent in pretrial confinement. Court will recommend any psychiatric or psychological counseling. Judgment be entered against the defendant for the amount of court costs.
Nothing further from the state.
Appeal.
Nothing further.